In this video, I'm going to show you how to convert JSX to TSX in React. We're going to take a component that is written in TypeScript without any types, and we're going to turn it into a TypeScript component. In doing so, you're going to see exactly how to add types to any React component, and you'll be able to start your transition from a JavaScript React developer to a TypeScript React developer, if that's what you want. Let's get into it. First, I want to say that this video will only focus on TypeScript at the React component level. I will not be doing a tutorial on how to convert a JavaScript project to TypeScript, but if you're looking for that, there will be a complete guide linked in the description below that like button. So here, we have an empty component without any types. We are working in a TypeScript file, denoted by the .tsx extension, but we haven't defined any types yet. This code will work as it currently stands for both JavaScript and TypeScript. The first thing that we're going to start with is props. In React, any component can receive props, which we can type. Now, there are multiple ways that we can type component props in TypeScript, but the most conventional way is to create a type for the component props and define your props there. So what we can do is we can create a new type called demo props and inside add any props that we want to this component. For example, let's say that we want to have a first name property of type string. The naming convention of this type is always going to be the component name plus props like we have here. In this case, we have demo as our component, so our type is going to be demo props. Then, once we have our type created, we can add it to our component and access its props. We can access the component function arguments by typing props over here, and then putting a colon and adding demo props like so. Now, the props of this component will be properly typed. With this, if we need to use the props inside of the component, we will get automatic type inference and autocomplete from VS Code. And we can do props dot and then see that we have first name available as an option. Now, usually, it's best practice to destructure the props in the function parameters of the component so that we don't have to do props dot all the time. So instead of defining it like this, we can actually destructure it and access first name directly like so. Then we'll be able to use this first name anywhere in this component. Next, let's look at state. State is fundamental to React, and in TypeScript, we can type it. Let's first import useState from React and then create a state variable. We're going to create a variable called count, which is going to be a number. So we'll do const count, comma, setCount equals useState and then give it a default value of 0. Now, in this case, TypeScript is smart enough to infer the type of this count automatically. If I hover over count, we get number. So we actually don't need to type this if we don't want to. The type is automatically inferred. However, if we did want to type the count explicitly, we can do it like so. We can open a pair of angle brackets right after useState and then give it the type of our value. In our case, number. Now, we've explicitly typed our state variable. And we can do this either way. It's totally fine. Some projects prefer inferred type, while other projects prefer explicit types. This is also really useful when the initial value of our state is undefined, but we want subsequent values to be restricted to a certain type, like so. In this case, if I remove the type, TypeScript can no longer infer what this type should be because there is no default value. So putting a type here will allow us to set count to only a number, even if we default it to undefined. Of course, we can type this in any way that we want. We could have count to be an object with a value property like so, or we can create a custom type for it and use that instead. We can also make this optional or nullable by simply specifying a union type. Next up, we have events. In React, we're often going to be working with events that users can trigger. Events such as typing on an input, submitting a form, or clicking a button. The types of those events can get very tricky in TypeScript, but I'm going to show you a super easy way to handle them. If we have a button and we need to give it a function to run on click, the easiest way is to pass it inline, like so. And then we can access the event directly from the function. This event will be automatically typed because TypeScript is able to infer its type. And then we can access any of its properties super easily. If we don't want to define this function inline, but rather define it in the body of the component, we can simply copy the type by hovering over it here in this inline definition, and then pasting it in our own function definition. This will allow us to easily access all of its properties in exactly the same way. This method will work exactly in the same way for inputs and their on-change event handlers, for forms with form submission events, and any other event in React. We can always easily access the types of those events and use them in our own functions. Speaking of functions, let's look at how functions work in TypeScript and in React. Here, we have a fetch user function that is currently without any arguments. If we wanted to add some arguments to this function, say a user ID to fetch, we would do it like this: user ID, type number. Then we'd be able to use that user ID inside the body of this function. If we wanted to have another argument, say fetch options, we'd add it as a second argument and give it a type here. For example, an object with stale time, number, or undefined as a property. If the function needs to return something, we can either return the value directly and let TypeScript infer it, so we can return an object with ID as the value of user ID, or we can explicitly type the return value of this function by saying that it will have an object with ID of type number. Then we can call this function, perhaps in a useEffect, and access the return value and have it be properly typed. We can see that user here, if I hover, is an object that has an ID property that we can use. Next up, let's see how we can create and type a ref in this component. We can first import useRef from React, and then we can create a ref called InputRef for our input using useRef. To give types to this ref, we can use the same trick as we did for events. We can actually add a ref property to the input, and then hover over the type that it expects and copy that. In this case, it's HTML input element. Then, in our useRef, we can create a pair of angle brackets once again and paste the type that we copied. Now, this inputRef is properly typed, and we can call all of its input methods, for example, inputRef.current?focus. Keep in mind that the reason why we need this question mark here is that this ref can be null, as you can see here. We can then pass this ref to our input, and it will work because it's properly typed. Finally, let's look at custom hooks and how to type them in TypeScript and React. Here, we have a custom useDebounce hook that takes in two arguments, value and delay, which currently have no types. To add types, we can do the same thing as we did with our function. We can just say that this value is of type number and that delay is also of type number. Then, in the rest of this hook, we actually don't need to type anything else because everything is automatically inferred. The return value, here of debounce value, is properly typed as a number. If we wanted to return an object instead, we could do exactly the same thing and it would also get properly inferred without us having to specify anything. The only case where we would have to do something special is where we are returning an array, similar to how useState returns an array with two elements. If we return an array like this, then TypeScript gets confused because it assumes that this will be an array of either a number of this value here or the function to update the state. It doesn't know that this array is only ever going to have two elements in this specific order. The fix for this, however, is actually quite simple. The only thing that we have to do is write as const where we return the array. This will tell TypeScript that this value is going to be a constant and that it will not change. So this will always have a number in the first position and always have an updater function in the second position. This way, we can actually use this hook in our component by writing const debounce count, comma set debounce count equals use debounce, give it our count, and then a value of 1000. As you can see, the types of debounce count and set debounce count are properly set, and we can even see that the syntax highlighting works exactly as we expect. And with this, we have a fully typed React component that we can work with in TypeScript. This covers pretty much the most common use cases that you will have for TypeScript in React components, but of course, there's a lot more than you can do. But that is beyond the scope of this video. Hopefully, this helps you at least get started with working with TypeScript and React, and eventually, maybe even making the transition from being a JavaScript React developer to a TypeScript React developer. If you enjoyed this video and you want to see more videos just like these, be sure to leave this video a big thumbs up. You can also click here to subscribe, or you can click here to watch a different video of mine that YouTube seems to think that you're really going to enjoy. And with that being said, my name has been Darius Kozin. This is Kozin Solutions. Thank you so much for watching, and I will see you in the next video. Ciao, ciao.